man. We started a series a couple weeks ago. Anyone remember the name of that? Yeah. So, not going to preach that tonight, today. There's a subtitle to that message series, and it was Experiencing God's Presence Everywhere. What happened to you? What's going on here, bro? Testing you while we're going? So I need to keep it down? I can holler? All right, amen. So, experiencing God everywhere. So I got to experience God this week. You know, he meets you on the mountain, and then he meets you in the valley. Remember, you know? Well, he met me in a valley. I'm going to share that valley with you. But I want to pray with you first. It wasn't what we planned on doing, and I'm part of my prayer tonight is going to be that God has brought forth a group of people that really want him. Like, no playing church. I don't want to play church. But the only way that's going to work is if you guys really want the Lord. Like, really want to pursue him in an authentic, real way. Like, the real deal. Right? You know what I'm saying? Okay, so I want to pray with you, and then we'll get at it. Father, I am well aware of my own fear and my own tension right now as I stand before these people that you've brought here. I understand the weight of what I often hold in my hand and what you've called me to do. I understand that it's not easy. No man in Scripture ever had an easy ministry. And for me to think that it would be is a gross disfigurement of true biblical ministry. And so I repent of that, and I want to acknowledge that it's difficult. And playing church is not what this church is all about. That is not what Revolution Church is. It's not what SNL Church ever was. It's not who we ever will be. And Lord, I need you to help me with that. We need to stay on focus. And so I pray, Lord, that your Spirit would go forth now and prepare every heart to receive a difficult word tonight. But I know it's from your heart directly, and I know you want to share it with your people. So I pray that that tonight would be an amazing night, an amazing day. I keep getting stuck in the night, Lord. I'm used to it. But an amazing time here as we gather to hear from you, to experience you, and to live the life that you've really called us to live. Lord, I also want to lift up my fellow brothers, my co-laborers in the faith, the other pastors in this immediate area that I have come to know and love and trust. And I know they carry an enormous burden as well, and they will step up on your platform tomorrow morning, and they will preach your word, and people will not like it, and they will be shamed and shunned, and people will ridicule them and rip them, and it's only out of their love for you that they stand. And so I pray, Lord, that you'd give them a fresh filling of your love in their heart, Lord, tonight as they prepare for tomorrow's message. Let their message be profitable tomorrow, that it would bring gain and momentum and advancement of your kingdom here in this community and abroad. Lord, I thank you for tonight, and I love you, and I thank you for letting me talk with these beautiful people. In Jesus' name, amen. So I have don't let the flowery happy shirt fool you. I have often dark times in my life that I walk out of here. You know, this is the height of the week for a preacher, to stand up and do what he does. But I let you into a secret. As the preacher, and this is unilateral, this is universal, this is, because I meet with these guys every month, okay? When we walk off the platform, we hit a low that none of us want you to feel. It's an awful feeling. It's when we get up and we're doing the one thing that we know we've been made to do, and then it's over, and it's like, oh, and it's never good enough. I tell you, there's no preacher that ever got up and when he was done said, you know what, we've graduated, we made it finally. No. Because we're crazy and we want to see one more person accept Jesus and give their life. You know, it's like it's never enough. It's one more seed and one more person and one more song. Don't let it end, and it's coming to an end, and oh, and so then I leave, and so here's the secret. So when I look out, right, instead of, and I think I've mentioned this before, instead of just being genuinely thankful for you being here and you being here and you being here, I am thankful. But I can't help that thing inside of me that looks at these empty seats and it drives me crazy. It drives me crazy. And so, but it's not just that they're not, it's not just that this seat's empty, it's who it represents. It's who it represents. See, in this church, this is a rare church. That's a great place for an amen. This is a very rare church. When I say rare in many, many ways, but one of the things that makes it extremely rare is the amount of people that have given their life to Christ through this ministry and been in this tank. It's a crazy amount. Over 200 people have been baptized in this tank, right? It's awesome. It is awesome. Praise God. But do you see 200 people here? That's what bothers me. And it should bother you. Like a holy bother. It should bother you. The reason why it should bother you is not because, you know, they stubbed their toe and they're at the hospital getting a stitch. Like that, I get it. It's the story behind the vacancy that should stir you in a godly way. And so I often find myself just grieving and lamenting over these empty seats. And it's not that they're empty, it's the story behind it. Why am I grieving? Because I'm constantly reminded in this position of the strife and the trouble and the disaster that's going on in your lives. I'm the first responder. That's just what a preacher, I mean, you know, I get the phone call. I mean, you know, you understand this, right? I'm not ripping on the people that work hard with their hands because my hands are wimpy and my feet are soft. But this is not an easy gig, and I'm speaking from my brothers in Christ who do this all the time with larger ministries yet. It's hard because you carry the weight of everyone that you love. And it's I'm just going to say it, it sucks sometimes. And so it's constant. I see the disaster. Families, and again, this week, just a family that I know and love just shredded to pieces. Totally destroyed right before my eyes. People that I know and love and you know and love, their lives are forever been destroyed. It can be better. It could get better. Jesus can. But you know what I'm saying? Like lacerated, destroyed, ripped apart. And I see like people just, divorces and addictions being relapsed and people go. I mean, I was talking to a pastor the other day and they asked me if I was pastoral. Do you go visit people all the time and pray with them and go visit them when they're sick? And I said, well, yeah, kind of, but I visit the jail more than I visit people's homes in our church. And they're like, but why? Why? I hate visiting you guys in jail. It's not that I don't love you, but I hate that you've gotten there. Do you know what I'm saying? I can't stand it. Failing marriages, jail, financial devastation across the board, which is one of the greatest reasons for divorce in our country. Failing faith all the time. You know, I got saved and I got baptized, but you know, it's just Christianity thing just didn't work out for me. Anyone ever hear that one? I hear it all the time, and it just breaks my heart. One of the wonderful things about Jesus is that he does meet you where you are. So God of the mountain, God of the valley. And he met me in that place when I was lamenting over not just you, but everyone who's not here. This is for the people that are not here. And I tell you this, even though you're here, so you'll never become the people who are not here. That's not what God wants. He met me. And I got to realize that when I'm sitting at home or I'm sitting in my office here, I'm in my car and I'm grieving over another destroyed family within my church that busts my heart open, that I'm not alone. And Jesus understands. And that's comforting to me. Let it be a comfort to you. I want to share with you out of Luke chapter 19. So I'm not studying for God of the mountain, God of the valley. I'm just reading for my own this week, and he meets me. So in Luke 19, verse 41, here's what it says. But as he came closer to Jerusalem, speaking of Jesus, it's about to be in red writing. Listen. As Jesus comes closer to Jerusalem and saw the city ahead, he began to weep. I'm already reading this. I'm going, oh, he gets it. He gets it. And this is what he says. How I wish today that you of all people, his people, the Jews, the chosen, the people that he came to save, the God who loves them. He says, how I wish today that you of all people would understand the way, remember that, the way to peace. But now it is too late, and peace is hidden from your eyes. Before long, your enemies will build ramparts against your walls and encircle you and close you in on every side. They will crush you into the ground and your children along with you. Your enemies will not leave a single stone in place because you did not accept your opportunity for salvation. Do you see the picture that he's painting of the just crushed life? Do you see it? Do you see it? I'm asking you a question. Do you see it? You do. You do see it. We're not living in a fortified city with a wall around it. But you can see the enemy of your soul wants to come in and crush your family, crush your business, crush your faith, crush your relationships, kill your kids, ruin everything. And Jesus sees this in people, and he begins to weep. And don't just think for a second he's talking about just at the end, he talks about the opportunity for salvation. A lot of us say, well, listen, we just got to get to Jesus and we can be saved. That's good. Salvation is delivery. And it's not just delivery from this place to someday in glory, whenever that comes. It's delivery in everything. It's a way he wants you to live. And here's this Jesus saying, listen, Moses, I'm with you. I understand the situation, and I'm weeping too because I see my people. I want to deliver them. I want to help them. There's a way, it said. There's a way I want them to live, and they just won't do it. And they're going to get crushed, and it breaks his heart. And it breaks my heart every week when I see this happening to you. And I don't want that for you anymore. And I know God wants better things for you. He wants better things for you. There's two words and they were key. It said the way. Do you know, long before this was ever called Christianity or Christians, the book of Acts in chapters 9 and in 19 calls this thing that we do and believe the way. We're followers of the way. And it wasn't just the way, the person, but it was a way. It was the way that this person told us how to live. Jesus said, this is how I want you to live. I don't want you to say yes to me so I can have eternity. You know, when the time comes, when he comes, boom, finally it's going to get good. No, 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 no. Now, there's a way I want you to live so you can enjoy peace and prosperity instead of being crushed. And his people get crushed for lack of understanding. The reason that I come to you tonight is to share with you what this way is. And I've been praying all week that you would just let it soak in, that finally I'm convinced that you guys that chose to come here today on Halloween, you could have done something else, but you came because you really mean business and you really want the Lord, like big time, and you want to absorb this and let his word permeate your heart and change who you are. That's what I'm hoping that you are tonight. Every person in this room, that's what I'm hoping. So I'm going to give you four ways to, yeah. Don't listen to anything I say, I'm dumb. Four things that he wants you to do so you can avoid the crash. Listen, I want to preface this by saying that if you do these things with perfection. I'm not promising you everything's going to go well. That is not this church. Jesus said, in this life, you will have trouble. Okay? So when you do these things, these will avoid the bad stuff, but when you inevitably get into it, because sometimes he brings you into it on his own to deliver something to you so you learn and grow. So when you go there, he said, but be of good cheer, take heart, I've overcome the world. So even if you do this stuff and things are going well and something goes bad, you can still come to me and I'll still help you. But to avoid the crash, here's the four things. This comes from I've been doing this now for 12 years. And this comes with 12 years of experience from listening to you. When someone crashes, it always starts the same. I don't care if it's because of an addiction or a divorce or whatever the tragedy is, it all starts this. Every one of you, there's no one interesting in this room. I'm telling you. Because it all starts the same way. Every one of them. Crash. You visit them in the jail, you visit them at the hospital, you visit them wherever. Where you been? That's where it starts. Every single time. There's a way that seems right to the man, and the end it leads to death. And we just seek the Lord in all that we do if you want your path straight. But when we stop seeking the Lord, boom, inevitable, you're gonna crash. There's no way around it. There's no way around it. So here's the four things. Listen, you have to do these things. And this is what I mean by real church tonight. Like, you have to do these things. You have to do these things. The first one is to abide in his word. Abide in his word. Do you know what abide means? To stay in it. Here's tough church. This is the truth. And if I've ever said this, please forgive me. I pray I never say it again. If I ever say to you, hey, just give him 5 minutes in the morning. Just read your Bible. No, don't. No, abide in his word means stay in. Don't throw God 5 minutes in the morning or 5 minutes before you're drooling yourself, sleeping in the bed, like giving him 5 minutes of like this little sampling. This is not a Whitman's chocolate sampler. Don't give him, he said, it's abide in me. Let my words abide. That means to stay in it. You know, one of the other definitions of abide is to be present. And let me ask you a question. Does it drive you crazy when you're talking to someone and they are so far from paying attention to you? Who else? Insane, right? You're talking to them, they're just like total blank stare. They're there, but they're not. Well, I'm there physically, but I'm not there emotionally, mentally, spiritually. I'm not there. I'm just there. Just like, zombie. Right? But abide means to be present. That means get in it and pay attention. Pay attention. Listen to him. People are always asking, I need a word from the Lord. Let me tell you something. Who's got a Bible with them tonight? If you got a Bible, raise it up. Just pick it up in the air. I hope everyone here does. Bibles open, notebooks open. That's the kind of church we need to be, right? There's 789,650 words right there. You want a word from the Lord? Pick up your Bible. Pick up your Bible. He'll talk to you. Now, that's King James. I don't read that, so I just lied to you. But it's close. It's close. So abide in his word. Here's what God's word is. Listen, I'm going to gorge you with God's word tonight. I'm going to gorge you. Will you ever walk out of Golden Corral? Just, oh. That's what's going to happen to you tonight. And every night that you come here, for the rest of my life, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to gorge you with God's word. That's the kind of church we're going to be. Okay? Here's what God's word is. I'm going to give you a what, why, and how. Here's what God's word is. 2 Timothy 3:16. Go there. Don't listen to me. Put your eyes on it. 2 Timothy 3:16. It's not the most popular 3:16 in the Bible, but it's right up there. Here's what God's word is, the Bible, the scriptures. You ready? All Scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us to do what is right. Now, before I read the last verse, I got to stop there because I love the New Living Translation, but I hate it in this case. It's a terrible translation. It's a thought-for-thought translation. Kind of trying to give you the idea of what God meant there. Here's what it really means. All of the versions say it, that all Scripture is, not was, is God-breathed. He speaks it. Now listen, the reason why I'm saying this, I had a revelation today. I heard there was a pastor that's there a long, long, long time ago. I can't remember what the guy's name was. Doesn't matter. He said the preaching of God's word is God's word. Now I started thinking, well, wait a minute. Now I'm not, what I say is not God's word. But then I read that again today. I said, all Scripture is God-breathed. So and this was humbling. So Lord, when I get up and I quote your word, I become howdy doody for you. I become your puppet. You pull the rope behind my head, and out of my mouth comes your words. You are speaking through me. That's what this is. The Bible is God's word. God's word. And you see what it's for? It's to correct us. We're talking about not crashing tonight, right? We're talking about avoiding the disasters of life. And God's like, there's a way I want you to live. And what is he saying? God's word is teaching us not to crash. It's teaching us what is good and what is not and what's wrong and correction and get us back on course before you crash. Every one of his words is for that. God breathed. He spoke these words for you to correct you, get you back on track. You don't need Dr. Phil. You don't need Oprah. You don't need self-help. You don't need me. You don't need her. You don't need him. You don't need anybody. You need him. You need the Lord. You need his word. It's the only measuring stick that's worth living up to on this planet. That's what this is. Why? Why do we read God's word? Why would we abide and be present, paying attention to what God's word says? Look in Psalm 19. Going blind. Terrible. Getting old. Why would we read this word? Why would we read this word? I don't want you to crash, God says. I want you to live in a... John 10:10, one of my favorite verses, he says that the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I, Jesus, came that you might have life abundantly. I want you to flourish and fly. I don't want you to crash. So here's my word. I want to help you. It teaches you what's right and wrong, gets you back on course. Look at Psalm 19, verse 7, just a few verses here. The instructions of the Lord... Tell me, where are the instructions of the Lord? Show me. Show me. The instructions of the Lord are perfect, reviving the soul. Who needs a bump once in a while? Revive the soul, right? It's right there. The decrees of the Lord, where's that? Show me where that is. Anyone? Yeah, right here, right? The decrees of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise. Who needs wisdom? And I'm simple. Look, no great theologians in here, right? No one's probably going to win president or anything right here, right? But just regular folks, right? So we're just simple folks. We're Lake County folks. So what does this word do for us? It makes us wise, right? It revives our soul. It makes us wise. The commandments of the Lord, where's that? Hold it up. Hold it up. Come on, hold it up loud and proud. The commandments of the Lord are right, bringing joy. Who wants joy in the heart? Yeah, yeah. Joy down deep in my soul. Right. The commands of the Lord are clear, giving insight for living. Can you see the Lord of the universe trying to help you to avoid the crash? Can you see it right there, right? So I would say the lion's share of our time would be spent here. Let's just go on. Reverence for the Lord is pure, lasting forever. This will just go quicker now. The laws of the Lord are true. Each one is fair. They're more desirable than gold, even the finest gold. They are sweeter than honey. This is a Halloween message right here. If you think going out tonight's more important than this, let God speak to you, right? They are sweeter than honey, even honey dripping from the comb. They are a warning to your servant. You see that? Warning, warning, danger. Will Robinson, you're going to crash. Pay attention. A great reward for those who obey them. I want a great reward. We're going to talk about that a little later. And he goes on, he starts asking questions. How can I know all the sins lurking in my heart? Cleanse me from these hidden faults. He understands, the Bible says if anyone thinks they're without sin, they're deceiving themselves. We all have it. And he's pointing that out. He understands that. Keep your servant from deliberate sins. If we crash and burn, I'd say that right there. Keep your servant from this. Don't let these sins control me. Then I'll be free of guilt and innocent of great sin. Now listen, if you got to have this underlined in your Bible. This is huge. This is for everybody here, right? May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you. That's the way we should be living. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, also what I teach and the way I act, let them measure up. Hypocrisy runs wild. We don't need that. We don't want to be that church, right? No more. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. So it's God's word. It's breathed by God, and it's to correct us so we don't get off the path. And then also we read it. Why? So we can have our soul revived. We can be wise because we're just simple folks. We need help. We read it because it brings joy to our heart and insight for living. Now, when he asks these questions, how can I keep from the sin? What am I supposed to do? Well, Psalm 119:11 tells us, the same author, he says, I've written your word on my heart so I wouldn't sin against you. That's what he said. How do you write some word on your heart? Can you open up your chest cavity and start writing? No. But if you, it's kind of like muscle memory, right? These guys that are amazing on tour, they practice so many times that this becomes the natural move of their swing, right? And it's the same thing here. You read it enough times, and that's the natural movement of your heart. Do you get it? So you have to keep at it. That's where he says, abide in my word. Stay in my word and be present. Pay attention to what I'm trying to tell you. So now I'm gonna go into a subject that's touchy here at our church. But I'm just going to preach with confidence. I'm not going to ask if it's okay. I'm going to, okay? I'm going to. Why is it that I preach so long here? People complain about it. They do. Let me rationalize. Let me give you two things. Let me rationalize why, and then I'll tell you the real reason why. Is that fair enough? Okay. Last year, 2014, four divisional playoff NFL games were played. Okay, and they haven't played them yet this year, so I can't give you stats. Last year, okay, during those four games, there was an average of 34.3 million people who watched a game. Now let me ask you, do you remember, and don't feel guilty, I want you to help the sermon, okay? Do you remember if you watched any of those games? Raise your hand. No? How many people frequently will watch football? Okay, but how many people, those same hands, will watch 1 o'clock and 4 o'clock? Raise your hand. Right? On occasion, sometimes, right? So these stats that say that those games, that there was 34.3 million people, would it be safe to say that they could almost double that on that day? Because they probably watched the next game too. By then, they're so hammered, they don't even know how to get up anyway, so they're going to watch it by default. Right? I'm having fun. How long is a football game? 2.5 hours? Some people watched both. 6 hours, if you include the time between when you don't want to miss all the replays of the plays you just watched. We will spend, listen, everyone, listen, seriously. We will spend 6 hours watching a football game that no matter what the outcome, it has zero influence on your life. No effect. You will not get a dime. You will not get a second of your life back. You will not grow any of your hair back. You won't become better looking or more in shape. Nothing good or bad will come out of that football game, and you will dedicate, I'm not just talking about you, but people will dedicate 6 hours of their life to watching a football game that has zero bearing on their life, but they will complain when I get up and I don't give you a little Whitman's chocolate sampler. I heard a pastor say yesterday that it takes 10 minutes to set the rig up and 5 minutes to take the rig down. And so who wants to preach 20-minute little sermons? You can't take a rig and set it up that quick and take it down. And you could never drill deep that way, could you? Because when the waves and the winds come crashing into your life, you need to have a strong foundation that you can bury down into to hold you up when the wind comes. So I'm not going to go up there and say, hey, here, let me just give you my 20 minutes of what I've been feeling the last kind of a week, and you should take it and go, you know, have fun. Like, that's not going to help anything. It might get more people in here, but it's not going to help you from crashing when stuff comes into your life, and I'm not going to do it. I'll never do it. I will never, ever get up here and give you a little 20-minute happy-go-lucky, tickle your ear, now go have fun on the playground sermon. It ain't happening here. It's not going to happen. Now listen, the reason why is what I told you earlier. Like, you are my life. Do you understand? You're my life. You're my life. I love you guys. And I love everyone who's not here now too, that is part of this church, that they're not here for one reason or another. But I love you. And so if I love you, I'm going to give you the greatest thing I could possibly give you. I don't want to give you, we have good, it's yummy coffee, but that's not what it's about. What it's about is for you to come, and I'm going to take the greatest gift I could give you, which is God's breathed words that help you so you can have the abundant life. I want to give it to you so you won't crash. That's what I want to do. Now, it's not just my stir inside that wants to do this for you, but I also understand, you need to understand, the weight of God's word that's on the leader of a church. I want you to hear these words, because maybe they don't resonate with you because it's not geared towards you because you're not an elder of a church. So, but I need you to understand what I'm living with. 1 Peter chapter 4. I'm sorry, 1 Peter chapter 5, 2 through 4. I'm going to read more than 4, I think. No, 4, that's it. So this is Peter talking and giving advice to elders of the church, right? And this is what it says. Verse 2. He sets it up in, you know, the first verse saying, I'm an elder, listen to what I'm going to tell you. I appeal to you. Care for the flock that God has entrusted to you. Watch over it willingly, not grudgingly, not for what you will get out of it, but because you are eager to serve God. Don't lord it over the people assigned to your care, but lead them by your own good example. And when the great shepherd appears, you will receive a crown of never-ending glory and honor. Listen, that's my prize. That's my prize. That's what I'm going after. I'm not going after the approval of someone who says, I can't come here, it's too long. I can't come here for whatever reason. Listen, the prize that Moses Robbins is shooting for, the only one that really matters to me, is right there. The crown that Jesus will give me of never-ending glory and honor. That's all I care about. That's why I'm doing this. It's not, trust me, it's not because of the pay. It's not because of the pay. Amen. I didn't even bother going to Financial Peace University. What am I going to put down on paper? Yeah. I'm looking for this prize. Now listen, I'm going to share something with you. I told you earlier I'm going to be bold because I have to and God wants me to, and I'm not sugarcoating anymore. I'm not doing what I'm about to do to be praised by you in any way. If you praise me for this, then you're lumping shame on yourself because you're not doing the same thing. I'm only doing what this says. It's not live a life that's in front of them that everyone should follow. Listen, I'm a preacher. I share God's word. And so it says here to care for the flock that God has entrusted to you, but lead them by your own good example. And in this context, we're talking about abiding in God's word, right? Is that right? Now look. This is my Bible. This is my, when I got saved, that's my Bible. This is the Bible that I got brand new, and that's what it is now. Because I abide in his word. Some of you in this room, only a couple of you remember this Bible. You were way back with me, okay? Highlights in pieces. Because I stayed in this thing. And that's why 12 years later, I'm just as excited about Jesus as I was when I got out of the tank, because I stayed in his word. And I read it so much, I couldn't put it down, and it fell apart. This is what a Bible ought to look like. I'm not praising me. I'm begging you. I'm begging you, stop the crash and pick up the Bible, right? So I couldn't preach out of this anymore, right? So I got another one, and most of you remember this one. I preached with this one for the whole SNL and most of this church, right? Look at the cover. See, I love this thing because it's got flop value, right? I could preach with it. But see, I'm blind now. I can't see nothing because I'm getting old, and the words are too small. Can anyone see those words? Yeah, you can't, but what can you see? I'm not bragging on anything, right? What can you see? Every page, look at this. Every page, studied, tore to shreds, man, I couldn't stand it. The pages in here are so, you could see through them because of the oil on my hands. Look at this. This is what a Bible should look like. This says, God, I need you, I trust you, I want you, I need your word. It revives my soul. And that's why I could get up and do this every week, because I'm in God's word and he revives my soul. Look, that's what a Bible ought to look like. Down with those little computer Bibles, right? This is what a Bible looks like. That's what a Bible looks like. Tore to shreds, you can't even use it anymore. So I couldn't use it anymore. So I got a new one. And I look forward to the day that I can stand before you and show you as this thing falls out of its cover. That's what we're supposed to do. That's the example. Like, I'm only saying that because I want that for you. I don't want to see you crash anymore. I don't want to see you burn anymore. I don't want to see you hurt anymore. I don't want to see families ravished with disease and chaos and strife and torture all the time, jail, addictions, people beating each other up, Christians feuding all over Facebook, ripping each other apart. Like, please, what about the part in Colossians that says that we do this, we live in harmony because we give an allowance for each other's faults? Like, if you don't read that and burn it into your heart, you won't live it. And you'll get online and you'll see someone do something and you'll rip them to shreds. They'll know us by the way we love one another. Sting. Okay, that's the first one. Listen, here's the second one, Ephesians chapter 4. Why do I do this? Ephesians chapter 4. So this is going to dispel what your job description is for me. And I'm speaking for all my brothers in Christ who are preachers, right? I want you to understand the real God, the real God's word, so we can have a real church that really rocks it for Jesus, right? I know you're in on that. I know it's what we want. Look, chapter 4 of Ephesians, it says that Christ gives us some gifts to the church. Right? And here it is in verse 11. This is why I do what I'm doing. This is why I won't give you a short little sermonette on what feels good. That's why I'm up here doing this right now, and I love you guys because you let me be honest with you and speak what this says, not what I think it might mean or what I want you to do. Now, these are the gifts Christ gave to the church, the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. It's what the people in Christian world will call the fivefold ministry. These are the five guys that will lead the church. Now in America, we don't have that right now. We have a lack of that, but we need it. You know what we have? One guy trying to pull this off. One guy. You know what I need? I'll just be honest with you guys right here, right now. I need some guys right there. I need apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. That's what we need. And that's when this church is going to flourish, when those guys show up ready to work with their Bible under their arm. Amen? Look, this is the responsibility of these guys, pastors. Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work, not the pastor's work, to equip God's people to do God's work. What is that work, you might ask? I'm so glad that you asked. It says it. How good is God's word? It says to do his work, build up the church, the body of Christ. Okay, so let's who plays connect the dots, right? You like to play connect the dots? Let's connect the dots. It says right here that the pastor's job is to equip God's people to do every good work, and that work is what? To build the church, right? What did 2 Timothy 3:16 say? You ready? Let's go back there. It's one verse I didn't read. It's to keep us from crashing, correct us, but then the last verse, verse 17, God uses it, his word, to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. You are not to look at the way I live my life, but the word of God that I preach to you. That is what will equip you to do your work of building his church. And so that is why when I get up here, it's verse after verse after verse after verse. So I just gorge you with God's word, because that is what will equip you to do his work, to build his church. It's not me getting up here and sharing my feelings with you. It's not me giving you more. I tell some stories. Some are just so funny. I got to get it out. It's kind of weird because there's way more people over here. So, like, it's not that I don't love you. There's just more people to talk to over here. So, you know, hey. You'll probably leave, right? No, I'm just kidding. That's what happens, right? Oh, I love you. So, what's the only way I can equip you to live a solid, purposeful life of doing his work to build up the church? Give you God's word in as much as I can. So if you're here and I have your ear, right, that's what I'm going to do. It's going to be the golden corral of God's word. I'm going to gorge you as much as I can. That's the first thing to avoid the crash. You have to abide in God's word. It's a treasure that you hold in your hand. It's the greatest gift given to the human race, is his word. Here's the second thing to avoid the crash. First one's abide in God's word. The other one is, second one is gather with God's people. Okay, gather with God's people. Now I want to dispel a false model too here. The false model is that the preacher goes home and he studies all week long and he fills up with all this stuff, and then one full man comes before a church of maybe 50 or maybe 500 or some church. I was just up at Willow Creek last week there, you know, visiting Kyle. Their auditorium seats almost 7,000 people. So is the church model, and this is sad to say, but this is what's happened in America. The one guy, he goes, he locks himself in seclusion, and he studies God's word, and he's corrected, and he's rebuked, and he's exhorted, and he's doing right, and he's got it all. And then he goes out on the stage, and he pours into all these other empty cisterns, just empty. So that's the way it is, unfortunately. But that ain't right. So you got to look at your neighbor and say, that ain't right. That ain't right. Jesse, that ain't right. That's not the way it's supposed to be. And see, the Apostle Paul, he realized that that's not right. He realized that it wasn't right. If you go to Romans chapter 1, look what he says here. Romans chapter 1, just two verses. Romans chapter 1. He says here in verses 11 and 12. He's writing to the people in Rome. He hasn't got there yet, but he writes, he says, "For I long to visit you." Right? Before we explain the whole thing, look what he says. I long. Like, it's not like, hey, I want to go to church tonight. Hey, honey, you want to go to church? You want to go to church tonight? No, Paul's different. I long to go there. Like, I can't wait. I can't stand it. I'm counting the seconds on the clock. I'm biting my fingernails down to the bone. Like, I long to go be there with these people. Right? That should speak to you. I long to visit you so I can bring you some spiritual gift. That's normal, right? The pastor comes in. He's filled up. He's doing his thing like I'm doing right now. But look what he says. He says, I want to bring you this spiritual gift that will help you grow strong in the Lord. When we get together, I want to encourage you in your faith. For sure, we get that, right? But I also want to be encouraged by yours. See, that's what most people don't understand about what church really is. a longing to encourage people, but at the same time, an ever-present longing in Paul to be encouraged by you. Do you see that written right there? I'm not making anything up, right? It's a longing to be encouraged by them, a mutual edification within the church. That's what we're supposed to do when we gather. Here's the correct church model defined. You know, it's literally defined in Hebrews chapter 10. You see the gorging going? Anyone getting full yet? Anyone getting full? Feels good though, right? Rumbly and you tumbly? Let's get some more. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24, the definition of a proper church. Verse 24, let us think of ways, let us, not the preacher, he's included in the us, right? Am I included? We're all in this together, right? Yeah. Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. Well, how would we do that? Do we call him up at the church and say, hey, preacher, I think we should fill in the blank. That's not the way it works. Why? Let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do. I hope you're not in that second group of the some people, right? Let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near, right? That's the model. That's what it's supposed to be. Listen. Hold on. That's the church model defined. Here's the church model displayed. This in action. Acts chapter 2. Church launch starts. Jesus ascends to heaven. The church age starts, which you're part of. Chapter 2, verse 42, all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Said this many times, I'll say it again. What does that mean? Here's what's amazing thing about God's word. It doesn't just mean one thing. You got to dig. Pray, concordance, commentaries. What's it mean? What does it mean to be devoted to the apostles' teaching? That means that you pen in your schedule time, solid time, to listen to it. And here it is. All 769,000 words. Right here. Right? They were devoted to it. And what does it mean to be devoted to? Listening to it, and then what? Don't be hearers of the word, be doers of the word. Right? They were devoted to that thing. Are you devoted to that thing? Don't say yes. Unless you're devoted to it. Right? They were devoted to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship. You know what fellowship is? That means living life together for a common purpose. Like, what's our fellowship based on? Is it on the Gators or the Seminoles or the Yankees or the Red Sox or whatever it is, right? No, it's not. It's Jesus Christ. Jesus said, Father, as you have sent me, so likewise I send them. That's our common mission. That's what we're supposed to be devoted to. Devoted to the mission of Jesus Christ to go make disciples of all the nations. Devoted to it, and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, communion, like we just did, and to prayer. They're committed, devoted to praying. Now I'm going to read quicker. A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. Now listen, not specific about what wonders were done, were they? Why? Why wasn't he specific? Because it doesn't matter. Fill it in. But he is specific right here, right now, coming up. You ready? Because he wants you to know something. He doesn't tell us about the miracles, but he does say this in specific terms. All the believers, all. How many is that? Every one of them, right? Everyone. All the believers met together in one place, right? That doesn't say, well, when they felt like it. Because they didn't have this game to go to, or that fishing, or that. I don't want to step on toes deliberately because you'll get offended, but no, it says all the believers. You know why? Because they were devoted to this thing. They had seen the risen Christ, and they were like, I can't do anything except this. Like, nothing else matters anymore. That guy just walked through the wall that we just saw die on that cross. I don't need to go fishing anymore. I'm on this thing, Jesus, with you. I'm devoted to this thing. They shared all the believers shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day. All the people shared everything every day. Crazy, right? If we did that, what would it do to this community? What would that do to this community if they walked into a place that did that? You think we'd have trouble filling seats? You think we'd have trouble finding greeters? Heck no. Everyone would just be like those early church guys. I'm in on this thing. Look at these people. They share everything they have. They pray together. They live life together every day, helping one another. This is crazy. I want in on that. They met together in the temple each day, met in their homes, because once a day wasn't enough. Amen? You get done with church, you go to their house and eat dinner. Yeah, Jessica, right? Yeah. Met in the home for the Lord's Supper. They shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people, even the people they didn't like. Woo! Feel it? And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. Oh, they're not crashing, they're flourishing. So, said that not to neglect meeting together like some people do. So I'm going to speak for my fellow pastor friends. And you may think that you're doing us a favor when you do this. If you've done it, I love you. But please don't call me and tell me that you're not coming because you're there in spirit. Listen, you don't phone in your spiritual gift. You don't email in God's manifest presence inside of you. You don't phone. Listen, do you think that those lights are free? You think that we advance the kingdom and go out and do stuff for free? You don't bring your gift of tithes and offerings by being there in spirit. None of the things that make up who you are and what we are get phoned in spirit. You're not helping anyone. Just do me a favor. Like if you're about to make that phone call, just don't make that phone call to me. I just beg you, don't make that phone call to me anymore. Your very presence here right now carries with it value. You want to know why? Because when you said yes to Jesus, his spirit took up residence in you. And so even though he's omnipresent, we covered this last week, right? Omnipresent, he's everywhere. But when you walk in the building, his spirit is manifest in you, right? So when you walk in, stronger dose, if you will, of God, right? And when two of you walk in, woo! How about 3 and 4 and 5 and 10? Right? Big, right? And then we start praising, right? He inhabits the praises of God's people. You know what? When you walk into, who's ever been to a huge church or a Hillsong concert? You're like, man, it's like walking through butter in here. It's the spirit so thick, right? You could do that here right now, every single weekend. Every single weekend that's available to you. Every single weekend, and I'm telling you, just being honest, you blow that thing off, you have cheated God and you've cheated your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ of that opportunity of manifest presence because you carry with you the Spirit of God inside of you. And when you, it was about a month and a half ago, you remember we ran out of chairs? Who was here that night? Awesome, right? Awesome. Who's been in here on a Sunday when we used to do Sundays? You walk into 7 people in here. Oh, yeah, let's go to that church. Hooray, Jesus. Am I lying? Who's with me, right? Come on. We're just having some fun here, telling the truth. No sugarcoating it anymore, right? This is what it is. Listen, every single week there'll come a time when God will encourage you to come and share his spirit and your gift that he gave you, and then the devil's going to come in and give you an excuse not to come. Who's ever felt that one? Everyone ought to raise their hand. Every single week. And I could stand up here and say, well, we shouldn't do it on Saturday night anymore because that's when everyone does stuff. We should do it on Sunday. And who would find time on Sunday dedicated to come, or would the football game start? I mean, come on, right? It doesn't change. You know what can change? Your decision to put a line in the sand and no more. No more. I'm going. So you bring with you the Spirit of God that's been deposited in you and the very spiritual gift that that same Spirit deposited into you when you came to Christ. 1 Corinthians 12:7 says that each one of us were given a spiritual gift so we could edify. Just in case you don't know what edify means, it means build up. How do you build something up? You make it stronger and bigger, right? You make it you got a gift to help edify, to build up, to strengthen the church, to make it stronger and to make it bigger. That's how you build it up, the church, not the building, the ecclesia, the people, the called out people, his people, his congregation. You've been given a gift to build that thing up, and when you don't come, you withhold that gift. I should have hit dollar store before I got here to hand you out, everyone, a piece of a puzzle. So let's just say that this room can fit 100 people, and you got 100 piece puzzle, and we put it, you need to use your imagination. Can you guys use your imagination? So imagine 100 piece puzzle up there, right? Can you see the meadow? Pretty, isn't it? What if you took 50 pieces out of it? Who would ever finish like that? Would you? Would you finish a puzzle like that? Why do you finish the puzzle? You want it complete and beautiful, right? Look at the empty puzzle pieces in the room. There are people here right now that aren't here to hug you, aren't here to smile to you, aren't here to pray for you, aren't here to give towards the ministry, to set the gospel forth to the world. They've withheld, and we all lack because of it. So I'm being honest, we pursue our selfish gains to go do something that we want to do. And our church family and back here, we pay the price. It's the truth. I mean, no one wants to hear this, but it's the truth. It's the truth. We've all been given a gift to help build up the body. We can teach, we can clean. Some people have tremendous administrative skills. They can cook, they can encourage. That means they can smile at someone. They could hug you, right? Come to church, it's silly, but Josh always gives me a hug. It's always a silly hug. He does it in some wacky way. He'll pull my nipple or he'll goose me or something. But you know what? As crazy and stupid as it might sound, he makes me smile. He makes me laugh. He makes me hurt. But it's fun, right? And it's an enjoy. Like when he's here, it's a better church when you're here, Josh. It is. Every single time I see Greg, he says the same thing to me. Good by the grace of God. And he smiles. He's going through cancer. How could I possibly be in a bad mood after that? Right? Who else is going through cancer in here? And look at him smile. Right? That's rocking. It's awesome. You can sing. All right. Excuse me. It was the tacos. So hospitality, right? You can just make people feel welcome when they walk in here. That could mean greeting. She's got a welcome shirt on. She's cats out there smiling today, welcoming. Or the people could walk up to a very, very scary, tall, black cathedral door with a brass handle. Huh. Right? Or a big black man like Rome. Yes, that'd be okay. Right? It's good. You know what I've seen? I've seen, as I sat out there several times, as I'm standing out there greeting, there's been times I've greeted with my coffee and stuff, and you know, we have a terrible parking situation, right? We have no parking lot. And I've seen cars, young families, drive up, and we're standing out there shooting the breeze, drinking coffee, talking to one another, which is good, right? We're supposed to hang out with each other, right? Good. I see them do this. They slow down, they go, and then they drive off. To me, that's utter failure. As we talk to one another, we have failed our community. We have failed God. Every single Saturday night, I'm just going to throw this out there. Every single Saturday night, there should be a man or a woman in that street with a parking fluorescent or, you know, the glowing reflector vests. And when you see people that seem curious about what's going on here, assume they want to meet Jesus, walk up to their door and greet them and say, I'm so happy you're here. First time, we'd love to have you park right here. If it's full, right down there. And then walk them in the building. Man, that's a gift, right? That's a gift. You know, speaking of my brother, Rome, out there, his van's been broken. He hasn't been able to do it, but he gets out there. You guys ever seen him spinning his sign out there? Anyone? You know what that does? It's kind of, you know, it's no big deal, right? It's just spinning a sign, but you know what it means? It means Revolution Church is here, and we want you. We would love for you to come and visit with us. That's a spiritual gift. Romans 12:8, there's a list of some gifts. You know one of the things that are listed there? Show kindness. Like, people want to talk about tongues and prophecy and laying hands and raising people from the dead. Like, I don't, that's not for most people. That happens. It's biblical. It will happen. He's got people out there that can lay their hands and there's miracles. But that's not for everybody. We all admitted a little bit ago, we're just all everyday average folks, right? But there's a spiritual gift that says showing kindness to others is a gift that builds up his church. Can you be kind? Who can be kind here? I can be kind. What does that look like, though? You know what's a beautiful thing about that is that it's not the gift of, and then specific, it's so open. What can it mean? What could it mean to be kind to someone here? Opening, holding the door for them, or getting them a cup of coffee, or smiling at them, or giving up your seat, or you see them with new kids, and you say, hey, let me show you where the kids thing is. Let me show you where the coffee is. Let's get a cookie together. Let me introduce you to my friend Josh. There's an error in every sermon, you know. I'm a flawed man. Here's another one, 1 Corinthians 12:28. It's another list of the spiritual gifts. You know what this one is? I love this. It's the gift of helping others as a gift that builds up the church. Helping others. Can you just list, if we went around the room right now, we could probably list 1,000 ways right now we could just help people out, right? How about this? Let's just help people realize that coming here and choosing Jesus and choosing to be a part of this family is a great decision. That's what we should do. In everything we do. And listen, when they walk into a room that's rocking full and they can't find a seat, they're going to go, whoa, God must be here. There's something going on here that isn't going on out there. I want to hang out. And then this awesome couple, man and woman of God, I'm going to use you because I believe that you are. You get up out of your seat and you say, Joe and Sally, here, come have my seat. I'll stand on the wall. You just help them realize that being a part of this is an awesome choice. We can help people, and it doesn't have to be this, all these great prophetic giftings and healings and this and that. Listen, you could just help people. That's biblical. We could just help people, and it'll build up the church. Ugh, dry mouth. We want to avoid the crash. You've got to abide in God's word. You've got to gather with God's people. Here's the third one. You've got to invite God's provision. Man, money, it just crushes families, doesn't it? It does. We've all been there, just crushing families. Let me ask you a question. How many people work to death? Working to death, and their financial situation would have to get better in order to say that it sucked. Right? It would have to increase tenfold just to say that it's in the crapper. All the time. And it's one of the great causes of family strife and divorce and craziness. Can I just share some truth with you? Nothing fancy. If you've been there, I want to read to you Malachi chapter 3. Why is it like this, you say? Why am I struggling so bad? Malachi chapter 3, verse 8, should people cheat God? Now you might think, I've never cheated God. Yet you have cheated me, he said. But you ask, what do you mean? When did we ever cheat you? And God answers, you've cheated me of the tithes and offerings. 10% is a tithe, offerings above and beyond for specific helps and advancing the kingdom and helping people out in Jesus' name. You've cheated me of the tithes and offerings due me. Due to me, I want to be faithful to his word. You are under a curse, for your whole nation has been cheating me. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse so there will be enough food in my temple. If you do, says the Lord of heaven's armies, the Lord of hosts, I will open the windows of heaven for you. I will pour out a blessing so great you won't have enough room to take it in. Try it. Put me to the test. Now, here's the result. Now, we're not farmers, but you can see the picture. You're all smart people. Your crops will be abundant. For I will guard them from insects and disease. Your grapes will not fall from the vine before they are ripe, says the Lord. Then all nations, people will come into your church, right? It says, all nations will call you blessed, for your land will be such a delight, says the Lord. See what I'm saying? When they come in and they experience something, they're going to go, wow, you're blessed. Now here's what they're going to experience. I got to ask you this. I didn't know who was going to be here tonight, except my wife and maybe Jessica. I had no idea who was going to be here, right? I mean, did I call you guys and ask you, are you going to be here? I didn't do that, right? But let me ask you, on a second, this is an opportunity for God to flourish or completely fail, but I think he wants me to do this. How many people in here, and don't be ashamed and don't be embarrassed, this is a house of love, it's a safe place. How many people in here have been consistently giving at least 10% of their income back into the kingdom of God through the church for the last 15 to 20 years and are miserable about it because their finances sucks? You've been doing it and your finances are terrible and you're mad at God? Has he let you down? Do you see what I'm saying here? No one who's done this could say that it's wrong because it's right. And he doesn't want you to crash. He wants you to do this. It's a listen, how many things in life could someone come to you and say, I'll give you, like, it's not, hey, I got a good hunch, third horse in the fourth race. No. How about if someone comes up to you and says, 100% guaranteed this is going to take place? How many times do you get that? Hardly ever, right? Right here you are. Right here you are. He said, if you will do this, I will pour out my blessing. And I'm tired of watching families crash. Right? And he is too. And he's telling you how to avoid it right here. And everyone in this room that has faithfully given of their 10% or more have never been let down by God. Never. And still, yet you refuse. And you continue to suffer. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. This is my way of loving you. I hope you know this. I hope you know. But I can't give. I'm hurting. If I had more money, I could start the process. I can't give. I don't have. How can you get blood from a rock? Now, I want you to know, chapter 8, verse 1. I want you to know, dear brothers and sisters, what God in his kindness has done through the churches in Macedonia. They are being tested by many troubles, and they are very poor. Anyone? But they are also filled with abundant joy, right, which has overflowed in rich generosity. For I can testify that they gave not only what they could afford, but far more, and they did it out of their own free will. And then it goes on to say that they begged. They begged. Please let us give. This wasn't a tithe. This was an offering. More. I want to give more. I'm broke. I want to give more. You know why? Because I love the Lord, and I know he'll take care of me. I want to give. I want to give. I want to give. I'm not being forced to give. Own free will. I beg you, please let me give more. Pass the plate again. Why? This is no prosperity church. It never has been, and it never will. And I'm not telling you that if you give this much, you get that. Some guys might do that on TV. That's not happening here. It's never going to happen because it's not biblical. But let me just share with you what God's word says. You jump down to 9:6. Remember this. A farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. Let me ask you a question. Anyone ever grow tomato plants in their garden? Anyone? Average tomato plant. You plant one seed. How many tomatoes would you get out of one plant? 25 tomatoes? Right? 25? Anyone? 20? Okay. So who's a mathematician in here? So if you have one plant that gives you 20, two seeds would give you, wow. And three seeds would what? Come on. Someone preach it. Right? Come on. Four, five, six, right? Who wants all them tomatoes? I do. I do. Look, the Bible says you can't mock the justice of God. Whatever you plant, you're going to get. That's it. That's what's going to happen. Look what it says here again. Plant generously, you get a generous crop. You must each decide in your heart how much to give. You see the free will thing there again? Free will. Don't force. That's Old Testament and New. Same thing, same God. And don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully, and God will generously provide all you need. Promise. God will, not might, not possibly. What does it say? Will. Then you will always, that's double awesome, have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. So what does it say? It says have everything. So is it a direct relationship? You give $5, you get $50? Is that what it says? Or does it talk about everything? Remember I talked about that principle of shalom? That means overall steady prosperity in all areas of life. My marriage is good, but my job sucks. My kids are great, but my home is underwater. Like bing, bang, bum. No, that's not the way it is. He wants overall shalom, peace, prosperity across your whole life. And this is how you get it. This is the exact opposite of what? The crash. And you see it right here. God's word. Faithful and true. Then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over. Why? To hoard? Oh, I got it. I got more. Right? Is that what it says? No. To share more. Look at this. Verse 10. For God is the one who provides seed for the farmer. See, he said, you ain't giving me nothing that it's not mine already. You put that buck in the box in the thing, it's mine anyway. If you don't give it, you're cheating me, he says it. Provide the seed for the farmer and then bread to eat. In the same way, he will provide and increase your resources and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. This is the part you need to get. Yes, you will be enriched in every way. See the shalom? So you can always be generous. Can you feel, as I'm reading those verses, as you're seeing God's word, as you're reading it, as it's sinking in, can you see and feel your heart being set free from the burden of providing for yourself? And the burden shifts to Almighty God, who's willing and able to do it with his feet up? Do you get this? Do you feel it? Do you see what he's saying to you? He's trying to help you to avoid the crash. My favorite Bible verse is in Colossians 1:16, that we were created for him. What's that mean? What's that mean? Well, I'm supposed to do everything for you, Lord, but my finances, but my this, but my that, I don't know if I can trust you. Matthew 6:33 is one of my other favorite verses. He says, the Father already knows all that you need. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously. That means the way I've laid it out in God's word for you to live, and he will give you, that's a promise, he will give you everything that you need. That's what it says. Seek the kingdom of God above all else. That doesn't mean I gotta get saved. That means I gotta get saved today. You know what it means tomorrow? I gotta get saved again. You know what it means the next day? I gotta get saved again. Why? Because things are happening and I need you to deliver me, Lord, from this. So I seek his kingdom above all other things, not putting him in the nooks and crannies when I have time available. Seek him above all things. Seek his kingdom inside of us so we would grow and go seek his kingdom by enlarging it by finding others. The prioritized action of intentional pursuit. That's what you see in Matthew 6:33. This verse speaks directly to our finances because it talks about how much I'll eat, how much I'll drink, what'll I wear, all the stuff we have to buy because we have to work so much to get it. And he's like, don't worry about it. Unbelievers worry about that. You focus on me and I'll take care of your stuff. Don't crash. Abide in his word. Gather with God's people. Invite God's provision. Here's the last thing. Share God's son. Share God's son. Our church here, Revolution, has a mission statement, identification, kind of an ID badge that represents who we are, what we do, and what we believe, and all that stuff. It's up there. That's what it is. And I would offer this to you. I would ask you this. Memorize that. Memorize that. That's what you're part of. And when people ask, tell me about your church, that's who we are. We're gospel-centered. That means the reason why we're here is because of what Jesus did. And the reason we do everything we do is because of what Jesus did. Gospel-centered. Everything comes from the gospel because of the gospel. We're gospel-centered, culture-creating community. That means we're a community, people together living a different way than the world lives. We have to be different, bringing beauty to the world. So something beautiful happens here when God's people get together. It's a new way to live. It's not like everyone else. And then we're released out of these doors to go bring that beauty to the world. And I would offer you this, that of all the beautiful things that we could bring to the world, music and art and all the rest of it, I would say, and this might just be me, but I think the most beautiful thing that we can bring to the world as a church is a harmonious declaration of God's love. I do. I think that the greatest gift that we can bring the world is when all different people, young, old, every ethnicity, male, female, black, white, purple, green, doesn't make any difference who we are. We all come together, rich, poor, slave, free, barbarian, civilized, lawyers, doctors, politicians, everybody come together for the glory of God. The walls that our society has are in the process of continuing to build to separate us, the gospel invades those places and rips those walls down so we could be united. The gospel is for all people everywhere. Everyone has the opportunity to believe, and everyone should be given that opportunity to believe. Jesus Christ went to that cross for every single person who walks this planet. Every single person. The gospel is for everyone, but. Here's the problem, and it's rampant through the church, and I'll share it with you. And listen, unless you're involved in this, you're setting yourself up for a crash, and I'll share with you why. Chapter 10, verse 13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's an amen spot. Bear with me, and then I'm getting there. But how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? That makes sense, right? You agree? Right? You hungry? You still hungry? You got a little room over here? A little bit more, right? Okay. Gorge me. Say gorge me. Gorge me. But how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? And how can they believe in him if they've never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? Down with lifestyle evangelism. Open your mouth. Open your mouth. You got to tell them. Listen, I could be the greatest guy in the world. Anyone have a friend that's an atheist that's so nice? No one will know him because he's long gone. His name was Clay. He used to work with me at the dealership. Thought God was the stupidest concept ever made up in human mind. Nicest guy you'll ever meet. Lifestyle evangelism? I want whatever he was, that's what I want. Because there's certain times that I can't even, after watching Christians act the way they do, I can't believe I'm still saved. Honestly, I mean, come on, right? You guys have probably seen me act in a way that goes, I don't even want to be a Christian if my preacher is that awful. Like, I admit it. And I'm like that with y'all. We're an honest house here, right? But Clay was the nicest guy ever. Lifestyle evangelism. No, you got to open your mouth. The worst people that ever walked the planet are the ones who wrote this book. Lifestyle evangelism? Paul killed you people. And you listen to his word and go, well, that's amazing stuff. What's wrong with you? Right? Come on. Yeah. But for real, David cheated on this. He grabbed this chick, had sex with it, had her husband killed. And you read these psalms like, oh, this is beautiful. Let's just sing to the Lord. What, from the adultering murderer? Lifestyle evangelism? What is that, a joke? How will they know unless they are told? How will they be told unless they are sent? Jesus said to his father, as you have sent me, so I send them. And Jesus didn't just walk around being nice, did he? He opened his mouth and he shared the kingdom so much that they killed him because he spoke. If he was just walking around doing nice stuff for people, they never would have put him up there. He opened his mouth, and that's what we're supposed to do as well. Listen, you know why I'm putting this in on this sermon? Remember Joshua, we went through it, chapter 1, chapter 22. Listen, Reuben, Gad, and half-tribe of Manasseh, here's your land, here's Sabbath, here's peace, here's prosperity, no more slavery, all good, farm, all this good stuff, you can pray to me, everything's great, but wait, you can't enjoy it until you help them enjoy it too. Remember last week, Paul's in the prison. His freedom was attached to his purpose. Remember I told you that? What happens when they start praying, singing hymns after they got whooped with wooden sticks? The jail doors open up, the shackles fall off their feet, and they should have run. But he didn't. Why? Because his freedom was attached to his purpose, and he knew he was alive, sucking in one more breath to tell that jail guard about Jesus. He couldn't live a life that was fulfilling. He even said in one of his books, he said, woe to me if I do not preach. I have to do this. And even though he could have run and been free forever, he didn't. He stayed in the jail cell, and he stayed, and he witnessed to that dude, and the dude brought them home, and the whole family got saved and baptized. You cannot have a good life unless you are sharing God's son. You are made for him. You are the agent of reconciliation. God is making his plea through you, and if you don't open your mouth, how will they know unless they are told, young man? How will they know unless they are told? You have to open your mouth. That's why 1 John chapter 1, it says, we've experienced all these things, and now I share them with you. Why? So that our joy. See, I experienced all this stuff with Jesus, and I'm sharing it with you. Why? So my joy will be full. I can't even have joy unspeakable unless my good news becomes your good news. You have to open up your mouth. So that's the four things. We'd be done. If you want to avoid the crash, you have to abide in God's word. You have to gather with God's people. Put it in pen, people. Listen, for the other folks, let me ask you, just a vote right here, right now. Just honest. Who thinks this night would have been better if everyone from your church family that you know that's not here right now was sitting in this room? Just be honest. So honesty in church. Invite God's provision. Stop crashing and burning financially, which causes massive, massive disaster in families. And share God's son. One of the most famous verses in all of Scripture, it's on coffee cups, t-shirts, bumper stickers. It's Romans 8:28. I'm convinced that all things will work out for the good to those who love the Lord. And I agree. But the last part of the verse says, and are called to his purpose. So you're called to his purpose. What's God's purpose? What's he doing right now that's outside of the reality that he doesn't need anything? Okay, we understand that. He needs nothing to be God. But what's his purpose right now? What's he trying to accomplish as we speak on this date in this year right now? Save souls.
saving souls, bingo, building his church, right? So if you want all things to work out for the good to those who love the Lord, oh, I love the Lord, I love the Lord, I love the Lord, but are you called to his purpose? Like me, Father, that you have sent me, I likewise send them. That's his purpose. That's what you've been called to. And if you want to avoid the crash in your life, you got to do these things. You got to be tracking on all four of these things. Abiding in his word, which is a treasure for your soul. Gathering with God's people. Bring his presence that's in you to your gathering. Bring his gift that he's deposited in you. Don't withhold it from your brothers and sisters in Christ to go gain selfish gain, right? Lack of a better word. Share God's son. Listen, to circumvent God's system is to sacrifice God's blessing. There's no way around it. Let these four things be like the instrument cluster on your life's dashboard. Abiding in God's word, gathering with God's people, inviting God's provision, sharing God's son. Like you're driving down the road, you're looking at the gauges in your car, because why? You don't want to break down. You don't want to crash. You don't want to get arrested. Let these, how am I doing on the abiding in the word thing? Is my gauge full, or am I, right? Get in it. Be present when he's speaking. Pay attention. How am I doing with gathering? I mean, they've gathered four times this month, and there's a men's group, there's a ladies' group, there's opportunities for God to speak into my life, and I can speak into other people's lives and use my gift to encourage them and to motivate my brothers and sisters in Christ so our church can do great things for the Lord. How am I doing with that? Or am I just like showing up on occasion? How about my provision? Look at my bank account and my stress level as a result. How's that doing? Or am I giving? Am I trusting in the Lord to provide for my family? Watch the gauges so you don't crash. So what I'm asking you tonight is to make a fresh commitment to these four, not just things, but lifelines. I don't want to see you crashing anymore. I'm so tired of it. I want to watch you flourish. And I'll say this. Is there anyone in this room, that can tell me that anything I said was wrong? I know, this is my heart, and I know without a shadow of a doubt that this is directly from God's heart, because he loves you and he wants to see you flourish. He wants to see you flourish.